We live in times where darkness approaches from all sides. God's creation, His precious children, are under constant threat of isolation, despair, and a lack of purpose. But Jesus called His church the light of the world, a city upon a hill, alive with the fire and power of the Holy Spirit. Together, we can fight the darkness. Together, we can beat back the shadows. And it happens through the simple act of invitation. An invitation can rescue the isolated, connecting them with a loving, devoted community. An invitation casts out despair, replacing it with joy, peace, and salvation. An invitation can guide those seeking purpose to the ultimate mission of God's kingdom, a lifelong journey of growth, outreach, and service, a chance to change the world. In this season of Christmas, it begins with a simple choice: to let our light shine, to make an invitation of hope.
passion now we embrace. All of your power in this place. Touch us now as we seek your face. We worship you.
We worship you.
We worship you. You're merciful and full of grace, Lord.
We worship you.
And the truth is, we never would have made it unless you were there for us, Lord Jesus.
We worship you.
Every time we shine, you're there. That's why we worship you. We worship.
We worship you.
Power. I see the promise. I believe the promise. That's why we worship. That's why we worship. That's why we lay down our lives. That's why we bow down and bend and
bow
and surrender and choose to lose. And turn the other cheek and walk the extra mile and give and give and give and give again, Lord Jesus. We worship you, Almighty God.
Good morning, Greater Mount Zion family and friends, and any new viewers that we have today. It is so good to be with you on this first Sunday in the month of December, amen, which is also the second Sunday in the season of Advent, which is that time of expectation, amen, where we look forward to that day when our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ was born. And so it is good to be able to gather with you on this Sunday. Amen. And to any of our new viewers, any first-time viewers, if this is your first time being with us and being a part of our online worship service, I would like for you to do something for me, if you would. There's a heart at the bottom of the screen. And if you would, please click on that heart to let us know that you are a first-time visitor, amen. And so we want to let you know we thank God for you, that you've taken the time to come and join us and to be a part of our worship service. Amen, amen. Well, beloved, since we have gathered together to worship our God and our King, we're going to do as we normally do, which is to invoke his presence. Amen, wherever we may be. So if you don't mind, please bow your heads. Eternal God, our Father, we thank you for another Sunday, God, that you've allowed us to gather to worship you. We thank you, Father, for this online platform, which allows us to be able to do that. We thank you for keeping us on last week, for blessing us with this day, God. And so, Father, as we try our best to worship you, we pray right now that you will allow your presence felt wherever we may be. Let us know, God, that you're with us. Help us to feel you, God, so that we may be able to praise and glorify you. Father, we pray that everything that's said and done in this worship service will be done to your name's glory as we worship you. So in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray now that you will bless us with your presence. Amen. Amen. Let's give God praise right now as we give him thanks and as we get ready to worship him. Amen. Amen. Well, beloved, it is prayer time now here at Greater Mount Zion. And as we get ready to go to God in prayer, I do want to ask that you continue to pray for all of our sick and shut in. Pray for those who we know are not doing well, for those who have been affected by this COVID-19 virus that still remains in the land. Pray for Sister Pat Jones. Continue to lift her up to the Lord and ask that he be kind to her. Continue to pray for Sister Corey Hawkins. Amen. We know that she lost her brother. So continue to pray for her and her family and for Deacon Hawkins. And continue to pray for Deacon Hawkins' sister. Amen. That God will be kind to her. I also want you to pray for a couple of nieces of Sister Kearns that has requested prayer. And we just pray for them and pray for all of our members. Amen. That are dealing with an illness. And then pray for their families. Pray for Brother Lee and pray for his brother. Amen. Continue to lift him up to the Lord. And just pray for all that we know who are dealing with health issues. My sister-in-law, my wife and I have a cousin named Maurice who has been diagnosed with cancer. He needs our prayers. So we just need to keep them lifted up. Continue to pray for our church. And also pray for Sister Watson and her family. Pray for her daughter, Nellie. And then pray for Sister Watson's sister who lost her son. Amen. Just continue to keep them lifted up in prayer. And as I was saying, pray for our city. Pray for our church. Pray for this world. Amen. Pray that the Lord would hear our prayers and that he would answer our prayers as it relates to what's going on in this world. I do want to actually pray for someone, a person that you don't know. Amen. The name is Duncan. I want to ask you to pray for Duncan. Amen. Who's having some health challenges. So pray for him. And then continue to pray for our church family because we need it. And then pray for you and pray for your family. You know what you need. You know what's going on in your family. So pray and ask the Lord to be kind to you. Amen. As he does for you what he will do. So if you don't mind, please bow your heads. Eternal God, our Father, we come now in the name of Jesus Christ. Father, praying, first of all, asking you to forgive us of our sin and asking you to please have mercy on us. God, we come praying for all of our sick and shut in, for all those we know who are dealing with health issues, Father. And God, we lift them up to you right now because we know you are the great healer and that you are still able, God, to work miracles in our lives. And so we lift up Sister Pat Jones to you. We lift up the nieces of Sister Kern. God, we lift up to you, sister-in-law Tina and cousin Maurice. And we pray, God, for Sister Corey Hawkins, Deacon Hawkins, and for their families. Pray comfort and strength right now during the time of bereavement. We pray miracles in the lives of those, Father, who have an illness that seems like it won't go away, God. But God, we know that you're able to remove. We know that you're able to heal. We know that you're able to deliver. And so we just ask right now in the name of Jesus Christ that you would work a miracle in the life of those we know, God, who are struggling with terminal illness, God. And then, God, we pray for our church. And we just ask you in the name of Jesus Christ to continue to bless us in this place. And continue to provide for us, God, that we may continue to do your will and your work. We pray right now for this city we call Milwaukee, cities all across this land, asking you, God, to touch the streets, that you would reach from heaven, and that you would end some of the violence that's taking place, and that you would remove the virus that's in the land, God. Father, we have to come to you and ask you to do that because we know you're the only one who's able, God. And so in the name of Jesus Christ, we ask you to do that. We pray for this world, God. Pray, Father, that you would forgive us down here and that you would have mercy on us, Lord. We know, Father, we've turned completely away from you. But we know, God, you're trying to get our attention right now. So touch our hearts and our minds and draw us back to you. Help us, God, to repent of our sins. And help us to recognize you as our God and as our King. Help us to recognize you as our leader. And help us to recognize you as our Savior. And so, Father, we just want to thank you right now. We want to thank you that although there's so much going on down here, although there's so much chaos going on, that God, you're still God who loves us. You still care about us, and you still take care of us. And so we thank you right now in the name of Jesus Christ for in the midst of all we're going through, you're still being good to us. That's something that we cannot deny, God. You're still good to us. And so we just thank you. We just praise you, and we just glorify your name right now. Because we understand, God, if you're not kind to us, we wouldn't be able to survive down here. But because you love us so much, and because we are your children, God, you continue to provide for us and take care of us. And for that, we tell you thank you, God. And so, Father, as we move forward in this service, we pray right now in the name of Jesus Christ that when we reach the point that we get to hear word from you, that you would touch our hearts and our minds. Help us to understand your word, God. Embed it in our hearts. Embed it in our minds that we would apply it to our lives, that we may be better people for you. And so we thank you for what you're about to do in this worship service. Thank you for any deliverance that you're about to do, God. In the mighty name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ's name, we pray and we thank you. Amen. Amen. Well, beloved, we're going to get ready to have our announcements. Amen. And then after the announcements, you will have the opportunity to worship God through your giving. Amen. Part of our worship is that we give to the Lord. And there's a couple of ways you do that here at Greater Mount Zion. A hand will come up that says, I want to give. You can click that hand, and that will take you to Givelify, which is the online giving app that we use here at our church. Or you can click the donate tab at the top. Amen. And you can give that way. But we want you to continue in this worship service by worshiping our God through your giving, because we know that when we give to God in the way that he has asked, which was in the form of a tithe and an offering, that God will bless you. Amen. And one thing we do want, and that is we want you to be blessed. And so as we get ready to receive our announcements, we want to pray for the offering. Because right after the announcements, we will have our offertory period. So if you would, please bow your heads. Lord, we thank you right now for the offering that's about to receive. We pray, God, that everything that is given will be given out of obedience to you and to your word. We pray, God, cheerful hearts and minds will give right now. And then, Lord, we pray that you bless those who do give, bless those who have a heart to give but have not. Take what is given, use it here at Greater Mount Zion. to do ministry for the furtherance of the gospel of Jesus Christ. For it is in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Well, beloved, let us receive our announcements.
Thank you. to you. Of the Lord in your life, give him the glory. How he brought you through, how he brought you over. You may not have everything you want, and you may not have everything you think you need, but as long as you got Jesus, he's more than enough. Come on, somebody, woke you up, started you on your way. Come on, say it again. Say it again.
Brothers and my sisters, we were to be honest. We would have to admit that we owe it all to Jesus. Amen. Amen. Jesus did it all for us, and we owe it all to him. We owe it all to him, our salvation, everything that we receive that's good and perfect. We owe it all to Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Well, beloved, I do want to thank all of you who participated in worshiping through your giving. Amen. We thank you for that. I do want to share with you, due to the fact that this is the first Sunday in December here at Greater Mount Zion, we do use this day to partake of the Lord's Supper, or practice what we call communion, which is one of the great ordinances of the church. And here we do it. I know some of you requested the cup and the wafer, and you did receive it. But going forward, the week before the first Sunday, and we will be mentioning this, you will have the opportunity to stop by and pick up your communion so that you can partake of it along with me. We normally, I will take it as pastor of Greater Mount Zion, And I stand in the gap between you and our God and our Savior. Amen. So when I take it, amen, you take it. Amen. And so, but going forward, I want you to have the opportunity to have your own cup and wine. And so you'll be able to stop by the church and you can pick that up. Amen. So that you can have it for the first Sunday. Amen. Well, beloved, being this is the first Sunday and being this is the second Sunday in the season of what we call Advent of expectation. Amen. I'd want to focus on the Advent themes as we go through the rest of this season. Last week, we normally would have focused on hope, but the Lord gave me a message that he wanted me to preach. And that message was, without a doubt, he's good. Somebody needed to hear that. And that's why the Lord, I know the Lord gave that message to me. Amen. But today, beginning with an Advent theme, we're going to deal with the Advent theme of peace. Amen. The Advent theme of peace. So if you have your Bibles, turn with me, if you will, to Romans chapter 5, and we're going to read one verse there. Romans chapter 5, verse 1. If you don't have a Bible, if you notice on the screen, there is a Bible tab. You can click that. You'll be able to choose whatever Bible version that you like and to read along with me. I tend to use the Holman Christian Standard Bible, the HCSB Bible. But you feel free to use whatever Bible version that you choose. But go with me to Romans chapter 5, verse 1. And this is what you will find there. Therefore, since we have been declared righteous by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Let's read it again. Therefore, since we have been declared righteous by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. My friends, if you don't mind, let us pray. Eternal God, our Father, we thank you for this preaching moment that has arrived. We pray right now that as we hear word from you, Lord, that you would touch our hearts and minds. Help us to understand. Give us what we need from this word, God, that will help us, Lord, to trust you more, be more faithful to you, and to be more about doing your will. I pray, God, that you would use my mind, my tongue, and my lips to proclaim your word. And I pray, God, that you would allow me the liberty to proclaim it with power and conviction. In the mighty name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ's name, we pray and we thank you. Amen. Amen. Why don't you take a moment and give God some praise? Amen. Well, beloved, from that text, I want to talk about peace with God. Peace with God. Amen. Beloved, we've heard of people wanting to make peace with God before they die. You'll be in conversation with them, especially when you are talking with folks and you are trying to get to that moment of sharing Christ with them, sometimes people will say, well, before I die, I want to make peace with God. I've heard people say that. I've heard that statement in songs. I've watched television shows and have seen an actor or an actress make that statement. They say they need to make, or they want to make peace with God before they die. Now, while that is a good idea, you have to wonder, what do they mean? Is there an idea of making peace with God, some personal meritorious act? Is it some good deed they plan on doing? Is it some philanthropic endeavor they're going to do? They're going to give away a lot of their money to help different folks? What's behind this statement? What is meant by this statement? Or do people know what they are saying when they make this statement? Well, my friends, on this second Sunday of Advent, I want to press the true biblical meaning of making peace with God. You see, it's not that making peace with God is unattainable. God wants to have peace with humankind. As a matter of fact, God desires peace with us. But making peace with Him must be done on His terms and not ours. Amen. God has a right and is right to set the requirements for having peace with Him. And beloved, those requirements have been set. At least that's what I see in our text. Paul, in this letter to the believers in Rome, enlightens them to the fact that they have peace with God. Before he moves to letting them know they have peace with God, Paul shares with them in chapter 4 how Abraham and David were declared righteous before God by faith and not by works or the law. That's why Paul begins this fifth chapter with the word therefore. Therefore means for that reason. And beloved, just to offer a little tip, when you're reading or studying the word of God, whenever you see the word therefore, go back to see what it's there for. Amen. Well, after Paul shares with his readers how Abraham and David obtained their righteous status before the Lord, he then shares with them the benefit of their faith in Jesus Christ, which is peace with God. Well, beloved, on this second Sunday of Advent, which represents the peace of God, we need to know that we have peace with God. As believers in Jesus Christ, we are no longer enemies of God. We are no longer at odds with God. The wrath of God no longer lingers over our lives, because now in Christ, we have peace with Him. And so as we look at our text, I want us to see what I like to call the three P's that will help us to understand the peace we have with God. And beloved, when we look at these three P's, understand these three P's have to be in order so that we understand our peace that we have with God. According to Paul, the first P is our position. This word position, as it relates to our text, means the place where someone or something is in relation to other people or things. In the case of the believer, it is our place in relation to God. And to help us understand this, Paul writes in the A clause of this verse, he says, therefore, since we have been declared righteous by faith, The King James Version renders it this way: therefore, being justified by faith, our position in relation to God is a position of righteousness or justification. And what that means is we have been declared righteous in the sight of God. It is the act of justification as a declaration of righteousness upon a heart that is not righteous. Can I say it again? It is the act of justification as a declaration of righteousness upon a heart that is not righteous. In other words, because of our sinful nature, which built in us an unrighteous heart, we could not position ourselves to be acceptable to God. Our works couldn't get us there. Our service couldn't get us there. Our holy living couldn't get us there. We could not pay our way there, nor were we smart enough to manufacture a way there. For us to get there, we had to be declared righteous. We had to be pronounced righteous. We had to be openly or formally asserted or announced as righteous. And my friends, it was God who had to do it. We could not do it ourselves. The late Episcopal Bishop Charles H. Brent said, "Peace comes when there is no cloud between us and God. Peace is the consequence of forgiveness, God's removal of that which obscures his face and so breaks union with him." You see, before we were declared righteous, before our status was updated to being justified, we were wretched and undone. Have I got a witness? We were no good. We were rotten to the core. As David says in Psalms 51 and 5, we were shapen in iniquity, and in sin did our mothers conceive us. And beloved, what David was saying was, as soon as he began to exist, that he was a sinner or had then a propensity or tendency to sin. And beloved, we were no different. But the good news of the text is, that's where we used to be. That's where we were formerly positioned. Now we are in a position of righteousness, and we got there by faith. At least that's what the text tells us. Paul says, therefore, since we have been declared righteous by faith. You see, being sinners, we have no works of righteousness that we can plead. And as I stated earlier, there was nothing we can do to attain our righteous position. We had to use the faith that God gave us. And beloved, even using the faith God gave us, we still have not done anything. Because if God had not given us the faith, we would not be able to use it. So when we put it all together, our position of righteousness is by faith in the Lord. Paul could make this statement with boldness because of what he stated in Romans 3 and 28. There Paul says, therefore, we conclude that a man is justified by faith without the deeds of the law. As a matter of fact, Paul stresses his point about faith in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 8. There he writes, for by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. By faith, my friends, we have been positioned as righteous. By faith, we have been justified. There was nothing about us that merited our position, but God blessed us with a position where we now stand before him righteous. Now, along with our position comes the second P, which is possession. Possession means the state of having. And beloved, since we have been positioned as righteous, we have a possession.
According to the text, the possession we have is peace with God. Paul tells his readers, therefore, since we have been declared righteous by faith, we have peace with God. Before, while sinners, we were in a state of enmity or hostility with God, and we could not help ourselves. Romans 8:7 describes the mindset we had. There it says, for the mindset of the flesh is hostile to God, because it does not submit itself to God's law, for it is unable to do so. And just to show you how bad off we were, when we were hostile toward God, we were unfriendly, we were aggressive, we were opposed, and we were angry toward God. We turned our backs to Him and resented Him. Now I know somebody on the other side of the screen saying to themselves, beloved, I didn't feel that way about God. Well, beloved, I hate to burst your holy bubble, but the fact that you were still in your sin, the fact that you were rebelling against God, the fact you were separated from God, the fact you were a part of His creation and not one of His children, you were hostile toward God, and your hostility was sufficiently proved by your rebellion against His authority and your transgression of His laws. But now, being positioned by faith, you have peace with God. That's a shout moment right there, because some of you knew where you were before you met the Lord. You knew, or you know, how hostile you were before you met God. But now, being positioned by faith, your faith that you put in Jesus Christ, you now have peace with God. Before, while under a sense of the guilt of sin, we had nothing but terror and dismay in our own conscience. But now, having our sin forgiven, beloved, we have peace with God and peace in our hearts, feeling that all of our guilt is taken away. And can I drop something in your spirit while I got you here? You see, if you know that you've given your life to Christ, and you know that God has forgiven you, if you're still walking around with guilt from your sin, I need to let you know that's what we call satanic harassment. Satan is trying to harass you to continue to feel guilty about your sin, although God has forgiven you. He wants you to feel that way, so that all you will do is walk around and ask God to forgive you, instead of trying to lead somebody else to Jesus Christ. That's satanic harassment, beloved. And if you come to God and ask God to forgive you of your sin and receive Jesus Christ into your life, I'm here to let you know today that God has forgiven you, and you now have peace with God. You see, we can't make peace with God because our best efforts on our best day are nothing but filthy rags compared to His holiness. Amen. It was God who took the initiative and made a way for us to have peace with Him. God provided an avenue whereby we might be justified and placed in a position of righteousness that would enable us to possess peace with Him. You see, God was never in a prolonged battle with us. He has always wanted to have peace with us. God was never in a fight with us. God just wanted to have peace with us. God was never trying to just bang us on our heads. God just wanted to have peace with us. He never intended to harm us. He just wants peace with us. The late Christian theologian J.I. Packer said, the peace of God is first and foremost peace with God. It is the state of affairs in which God, instead of being against us, is for us. No account of God's peace, which does not start here, can do other than mislead. Our peace with God is the result of our position. Because of our position, we have a possession. And beloved, it all came to be because of the third P. It came to be through a person. As Paul wraps up this verse, talking about our position and our possession, he lets us know how it happened. Since we could not do it ourselves, Paul enlightens his readers and us to the channel God provided that we may have peace with him. Let us read the text again. Paul says, therefore, since we have been declared righteous by faith, we have peace with God, watch this now, through our Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus is the channel and the person who God used to position us and to give us a possession, which is peace with him. My brothers and my sisters, it is through Jesus Christ that we are able to have access. And that word access means the right or opportunity to use or benefit from something. Well, through Christ, we have the right and the opportunity to have peace with God by means of his atoning death on Calvary's cross. He procured or obtained access for us to be at peace with God. There was nothing about us that could do it. But through Jesus Christ, we now have peace with God. Now, beloved, I brought up the term access for a special reason, because one of the main benefits of having peace with God is now we have access to the presence of God. Before we received Christ as our Lord and Savior, we did not have access. But now in Christ, we are able to enter into the presence of God. Are you with me? The story is told about a little boy who once stood outside the gate of Buckingham Palace in London. He wanted to talk to the king, but was sternly turned away by the guards at the gate. Well, as he stood there crying, a well-dressed man approached him and asked the little fellow why he was so upset. The little boy told the man his story, and when he had heard the reason behind the little boy's tears, the man smiled and said, here, hold my hand. I'll get you in. Just you never mind those soldiers. And the little boy took the stranger's hand, and together they approached the gate. When the soldiers saw them coming, they all snapped to attention and opened wide the gate for the stranger and the little boy to enter. He was led through the gate, led across the courtyard, led down carpeted hallways, and led through open doors, until finally he was brought into the very presence of the king himself. What got him there? Well, he was holding the right hand. You see, the kind stranger was none other than the Prince of Wales, the king's own son. Well, my brothers and my sisters, there's only one way to have peace with God and to enter his presence, and that is through a person, and that person is his son, Jesus Christ. You can't get to him no other way. You can't get to him through some ideology. Philosophers can't get you there. Being good won't get you access. All the money in the world can't buy it for you. To have peace with God, you must come through Jesus Christ. John said it in John 14 and 6. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. Jesus is the way to peace with God. You can't get through it through mama salvation. You can't get to it through daddy's salvation. You can't get to it through big mama's salvation. Nor can you get to it through Madea's salvation. You have to get your own by coming through Jesus Christ. That's how you get access into his presence, and that's how you get to have peace with God. Well, beloved, as I prepared to preach, I read a story about an old saint who was dying. He was visited by a friend who asked him, "Have you made your peace with God?" The man replied, "No, no, I haven't." And to that, his friend said, "What? You must make peace with God." And the man said, "I'm sorry, but I cannot do that." His friend said, "But you must. Don't you know that it is dangerous to die without making peace with God?" To this, the dying man said, "But how can I make peace with God?" He said, "You see, my Lord made peace with me 2,000 years ago when he died on the cross, and I accepted his death on the cross." And he said, "Ever since then, I've had peace with God." Colossians chapter 1 and verses 19 and 20 says, "For God was pleased to have all of his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile everything to himself, by making peace through the blood of his cross, whether things on earth or things in heaven." Beloved, through Jesus Christ, we were positioned as righteous before God. Through Jesus Christ, we gained possession to peace with God. Through Jesus Christ, we now have access to the presence of God. Through Jesus Christ, we now have a relationship with God. Through Jesus Christ, we now have a home in glory. Through Jesus Christ, we are now able to call God our Father, because it was Jesus Christ who died on the cross for our sin. It was Jesus Christ who God raised on the third day, and it is Jesus Christ who is coming again. My friends, because of Jesus Christ, we now have peace with God. And beloved, that's good news, because knowing we have peace with God, we no longer have to fear the wrath of God. So when people say they need to make peace with God, tell them the Prince of Peace, who is Jesus Christ, has already taken care of that. They just need to accept him by faith, and they will have peace with God. It's good to know, beloved, that now in Christ, we have peace with God. And what that means is we no longer have to worry about the wrath of God. We no longer have to worry about being eternally separated from God. We no longer have to worry about God kicking us out of the Lamb's Book of Life, because now in Jesus Christ, we have peace with God. We can get along with God. We can fellowship with God. We can call him our Father, and he calls us his child. Now through Jesus Christ, we have peace with God. We have shalom that was destroyed in the Garden of Eden. We now have peace with him. So when somebody says they need to make peace with God, tell them to hold on for a minute, because in order to make peace with God, you have to accept what Jesus Christ has did on the cross for their sin. So no, we can't make peace with God, because God has already made a way to make peace with us. All we have to do is accept what he's done through his son, Jesus Christ. And beloved, when you do that, then you have peace with God. There's nothing we can do to make peace with God, because God has already taken the initiative to make peace with us. We just have to accept it, beloved. Accept Jesus Christ, because he died on the cross for our sin. He is the one who God raised on the third day. He's the one who's at the right hand of the Father. He's the one who's coming again. He's the one who God looks through as he looks at us now. That's why we're able to stand before him justified and righteous. God took the initiative to make peace with us. We just have to accept what he's done through his son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Well, beloved, thank you for your attention. We want to take this moment right now to extend Jesus Christ to someone who may be watching our worship service. You don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. In essence, you don't have peace with God. Well, if you want peace with God, you must accept his son, Jesus Christ, as your Lord and Savior. You must believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sin. You must accept the fact that he died for your sin. And then you must believe that on the third day, God raised him from the grave. And you must believe in your heart that he is coming again. And if you want to do that, we want to ask you not to allow this opportunity to pass you by. Receive Christ right now as your Lord and Savior. If you want to do that, click the hand that just popped up that says, I want to commit my life to Jesus. And when you click that, that'll take you to our church website. You will see the plan of salvation there. You can also contact us from that page and let us know about the decision that you made. Or if you're not afraid, you can let us know in the chat area that you want to commit your life to Jesus Christ. Or you can click the request prayer button. Come into the host area where I am, and it will just be you and I. We can have that conversation about the decision you've just made. Maybe you're watching and you know Christ, but you don't have a church home. You're searching for a place to worship and serve the Lord. Well, I can think of no greater place than Greater Mount Zion. Amen. If you're living in the city of Milwaukee. So we would ask you to do the same. And as those who are contemplating and thinking about making that decision, I do want to ask those of us who know Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, that you would bow your heads and pray. Pray that God would touch the heart of someone right now. Draw them into the saving grace of Jesus Christ, that they may have peace with him. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Eternal God, our Father, Lord, we thank you for your word. Thank you, God, for Holy Spirit. We thank you for Jesus Christ, died on Calvary's cross, God, that we not only be saved, but that we would have peace with you. We pray for those who are contemplating making a decision for Jesus Christ or becoming a part of our church family. We just ask you right now in the name of Jesus Christ, God, that you would touch their hearts and minds and draw them into peace with you. In Jesus Christ's name, we pray and we thank you. Amen. 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 Well, beloved, thank you all so much. And I do pray that all of you have peace with God through Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Well, this is the first Sunday in the month of December. This is the time when we celebrate our Lord and Savior by participating in communion or the Lord's Supper. So if you don't mind, we want to do that. Get ready to do that right now. If you don't have wafer and a cup, don't worry about it, as was stated. When I take it, amen, I take it for you and for myself before the Lord. Amen. So let us pray for the communion right now. Eternal God, our Father, we thank you for another opportunity to partake of the Lord's Supper. We thank you, Father, for Jesus Christ, who died on Calvary's cross for our sin, and whose blood was shed for us. So right now, Lord, we ask that you would turn this wafer and this juice from carnal to spiritual as we partake of the Lord's body and of his blood. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Well, beloved, on that night in the upper room, after Jesus and his disciples had finished eating the Passover meal, Christ took the bread that was there. He broke it and gave thanks for it. He passed it out to his disciples and he told them to take, eat. This is my body, which will be broken for you. And he says, as often as you eat of this, you will do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, as we remember what Jesus Christ has done for us on Calvary's cross, we partake of the bread as we remember his dying on the cross for our sin. Amen. Well, after they had eaten the bread, Christ took the cup and lifted it up and gave thanks for it. And he passed it out to the disciples, told them to take, drink. This is my blood, which will be shed for you. And he said, as often as you drink of this cup, you'll do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, beloved, as we drink from the cup, we remember the blood of Jesus Christ that was shed for our sin. Amen. Well, after they had eaten the bread and the drink from the cup, they got up. And normally they would have had a benediction, but this time they didn't have one, because this would be the last time that Christ would be with them eating the Passover meal. He knew he was on his way to Calvary's cross to die for the sins of the world. So what they did was they got up and fellowshiped with one another, made their way out to the Mount of Olives, where they would be tried and tempted by Satan. Here at Greater Mount Zion, if we are not given the right hand of fellowship to someone who has become a part of our church family, we stand up and we give God praise for Jesus Christ dying on the cross for our sin. So if you will, right where you are, stand up and give God praise and thank him right now for Jesus Christ, who died on Calvary's cross for our sin. Amen. 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 Well, beloved, thank you all so much for being a part of our worship service. We do thank God for you. I do pray that you have a wonderful day and a wonderful week. Remember, tomorrow we have prayer meeting on Zoom from 6 to 7. On Wednesday, we will have Bible study. We're in John chapter 6 right now. And we do that on Zoom also. So some of you have been getting the email and I haven't seen you in Bible study yet. I do pray that you would join us. If there are any new viewers or those who have not given me their email, please provide your email. Amen. If you want to be a part of our Bible study or our prayer meeting. And then remember, Sunday school is on Saturday at 10 a.m. Amen. Amen. Well, listen, beloved, just like the disciples did, they did not have, Jesus and the disciples did, they did not have a benediction, and neither do we. But we do thank God for you, and we thank God for Jesus Christ. So enjoy your day. Have a wonderful week. God bless you. We love you.
Forgiven.